Okay. So, about a month ago, we ended, or about 3 weeks ago, we ended a lecture series on the Renaissance principle of history. The purpose of that was to give people a better sense about what is this idea of a Renaissance, which is more than just something locked in time or space to a certain civilization or another. Hold on, I'm getting a message here. Oh, okay. Sorry, I'm being told to look in the camera. Okay. So the idea of Renaissance itself is a very abused word, which is often applied to a certain period of, let's say, the 15th century Europe, or the Islamic Renaissance that occurred in the 8th century in the Middle East. But there's more to it than a lot of people realize. And what we did in the course of these six lectures was to take case studies of the Chinese cultural matrix, the Islamic, the Jewish, the Christian, as well as the pre-Christian movements of Socrates and Cicero, just to sort of see what is it in all human civilizations that has a certain commonality, an intention to not settle with a status quo of empire or a fixed set of relationships based upon certain limitations of resources, certain mathematical descriptions of the universe, but rather to tap into certain poetic creative capabilities to transcend those limits and discover new resources, discover new techniques, new technologies, new physical principles that can be then translated into the form of new insights into the universe that give mankind a power of action, of sustaining our life at a higher quality, at a higher quantity of our species, which again, if we look for it, even though it has different appearances, we find it in every civilization. So it's something which, especially today, since we are a world community, I mean, the world, we have 8 billion people almost. We have a clash of paradigms between a unipolar system premised around certain ideas of divide to conquer, keeping the slaves and serfs as ignorant as possible, such that they cannot actualize their innate potentials. This is something which is, it's not a new phenomenon. As we see, it goes back a very long time. It is what Socrates, Plato, Cicero, Augustine, Dante, Charlemagne, Confucius and Mencius were all up against as a principle of human social organization. And that you might want to call it the Dark Age principle. So we've got two sort of clashes. Obviously, the multipolar alliance isn't perfect, but it does tap into and express a certain orientation which has been suppressed historically. So when that lecture cycle ended, we thought it was going to be a very nice idea to follow the leap of that Renaissance process after the European world had become swept away in division, religious war, after the Renaissance period was over, and no longer fertile soil could really be found in those grounds. And we find all of a sudden a movement in the New World as early as 1630 with John Winthrop Jr., the Mathers, and others who were in connection with people like Leibniz, who set into motion a process that we later came to know as the American Revolution and the Republic. Obviously today, most people don't think of America that way. They've got a very limited closed idea of what it was as just like a bunch of rebellious colonists who didn't want to pay taxes and didn't like Indian tea or whatever. There's so much more to it, and you can't really understand a lot of the processes of the world today if you don't really get a better appreciation for the broader global dynamics of the American experience, both in 1774, but like I said, as early as 1630 and even before that. So in this current lecture cycle, what we have is we started with a class on the genius of Benjamin Franklin and the international networks that he cultivated. We also looked a little bit at why Quebec failed to accept the challenge, the Ben Franklin challenge, to become the 14th member of the rebelling colonies. Last week, we looked at Anton Chaikin. We got a beautiful presentation from him, who's going to be delivering or publishing a book very shortly on Prometheus in America, where he was able to just introduce a lot of the, again, British partners of Ben Franklin before the revolution. And we followed the growth of the American system that Ben Franklin, Hamilton, and others fought for throughout the 19th century, but very summary. There's a lot still to be explored. Today, I have the honor of introducing a longtime friend, Sam Labrier, who's an engineer. He has been somebody who's worked in the nuclear industry in Canada. He's worked in optical engineering as well, tied to biophysics. He's a historian, and we've had the pleasure on the Canadian Patriot website of publishing some of his wonderful pieces, including a recent piece going through the American system of the 19th century and the Civil War in opposition to the British. I've not seen this thesis tackled in that way, so I was very happy to publish it. Sam is going to be introducing another highly suppressed and forgotten chapter of pre-American history and also American history. What is it that caused America to be what it was? By looking at some of the French Cameralist examples. I'm not going to say anything more because that's Sam's job. So Sam, I'll just leave it up to you, and I'm going to give you hosting privileges now so that you can both do a screen share, but you can also invite, you have the sole authorization to accept new people who are coming into the meeting late, okay?
Okay.
So give me one second here to give you hosting privileges. All right, Sam, you are now the host.
Okay.
Excellent.
Okay. So, can everybody see the screen with the roots of the American system?
Yes.
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 All right. So thank you, Matt, for the introduction. Just want to ask if everybody's okay for doing readings during this presentation. Sure. If I just call on people randomly. Anyway, if you don't want to do a reading, it's fine. Just say, you know, no thank you, and we'll just pass it to somebody else. Okay?
Good for me.
Sorry?
For me.
Good for you. Okay. So as today is July 12, 2020, it's the 216th anniversary of Alexander Hamilton's death at the hands of the traitor Aaron Burr. It seems appropriate to begin our investigation of the roots of the system that Hamilton would work so hard.
Anniversary of Alexander Hamilton's death. I've got to text Zach.
Today is, yes.
I can fix this, don't worry. Oh, wait, no, you can, Sam. You have you're the host, so you can mute people if you need be. But somebody who just spoke, we can hear you, so you need to go on mute.
Sorry, me. Hang on.
Yeah, I wonder if during the presentation, people can mute themselves, so we can just get
through
it.
Yeah, unless quiet room by yourself, that's okay. But otherwise, yeah, please mute.
And I just want to tell everybody that questions at the end will not be a problem. I'll have as much time as you want for any questions that you have, okay? So while he's not the immediate focus of this talk, I'd like to open with a small portion of Friedrich Schiller's The Constitutions of Lycurgus and Solon, because these words have stuck with me since I first read them, and I hope it will be shown that what they say goes to the heart of what we'll be discussing here, which is the roots of the American system. Somebody want to volunteer to read?
Hi, man.
All right, Hugh, go ahead.
The legislation of Lycurgus and Solon. The state itself is never the purpose. It is important only as the condition under which the purpose of mankind may be fulfilled. And this purpose of mankind is none other than the development of all the powers of people. It is progress. If the constitution of a state hinders the progress of the mind, it is contemptible and harmful. However well thought out it may be otherwise, and however accomplished a work of its kind, its longevity then serves the more to reproach it than to celebrate its glory. It is then merely a prolonged evil. The longer it exists, the more harmful it is. In general, we can establish a rule for judging political institutions, that they are only good and laudable to the extent that they bring all forces inherent in persons to flourish to the extent that they promote the progress of culture, or at least not hinder it. This rule applies to religious laws as well as to political ones. Both are contemptible if they constrain a power of the human mind, if they impose upon the mind any sort of stagnation.
Okay, thank you so much, Hugh. So one of the biggest problems that one faces today when trying to organize solutions to economic and societal decline is a lack of understanding of the true historic mission of the United States. I myself have had my mind held hostage by such thinking. In my youth, from about 1997 to 2003, I was a devout follower of the American anarchist Noam Chomsky. His historical and political analysis always contends that there's no difference between the America of the post-World War II era, the one in which the CIA overthrows nationalist government, with Alexander Hamilton and Abraham Lincoln. Am I still there?
No,
you're
Sam.
Breaking up. We can't really hear you.
Yeah, that's not good. Oh, no.
Not good.
Breaking, yeah. And it's really just Sam, that we're having trouble hearing?
Hey, Sam. Maybe
me, yeah.
Just switch us back to host because maybe that's hard on your computer. I don't know.
Are we good?
Yeah, it's better. So maybe your computer can't handle being host. I don't know. We can try again, and if it happens, maybe we can switch back the host to us.
Yeah, let's.
You just tell
let's
us.
Try again.
Well, you're breaking up.
I'm on. Okay, so. Says I've got strong Wi-Fi, so I don't know.
Because one thing you could do is email me your PowerPoint, and you could tell me when to switch through your PowerPoint, perhaps. That might be an issue.
No, it's good to just make us host.
We're host.
Oh, right.
Yeah. That's the only downside of
it. Yeah.
Okay. Am I still breaking up, or am I okay?
Well, you got to switch.
Better. It's better now.
Yeah.
Okay, let's try again.
Okay.
And
if it doesn't work, then just email me your PowerPoint and you'll make us host. And you can tell us when to go through your PowerPoint. And maybe that'll work better.
Okay. Am I still host right now?
You're still host right now. So
you can still see the PowerPoint?
No, you have to stop a screen share and redo the screen share so that we can see your PowerPoint once more.
Okay. No, it says I'm not host anymore.
Oh, okay. All right. Let's... Sam is. Okay, one second, Sam. Sorry, Sam. Okay. Make host. Okay, Sam, you are the host again. Really sorry about that. Okay, we'll give her another shot.
All right, so you can see it?
Yeah.
Okay, so he sees no difference between that and the America of Ben Franklin, Alexander Hamilton, and Abraham Lincoln. According to him, America has always been an empire, and its conduct today is totally consistent with its history. This is true of many of Chomsky's allies, whom I also admired, like Howard Zinn. This historical sophistry, like a virus, infected my young mind, rendering me unable to conceive of any solution except radical revolution implementing an anarchist utopia. And it didn't help that as a radical leftist, I also saw great virtue in radical environmentalism and great evil in development. It wasn't until a younger Matt Arrett met me on the streets of Montreal in 2009 and gave me a copy of an LPAC documentary called 1932 that I began the process of unlearning all the illusions and sophistries which had previously wrapped my mind like a straitjacket. The fact is that prior to the 1970s and the Vietnam War, America was the most popular country in the world. People from all over the world clamored to emigrate there in pursuit of the American dream. The American dream was a real thing, but what was the American dream founded on? What built the American dream? And what has happened to destroy the American dream? I will argue that we cannot find a viable solution to today's problems without understanding the historic mission of the United States, and that the principles on which the American dream are built are universal, and it applies to any nation at any time. Friedrich List, who we will deal with in a future installment in this series, called it the national system, which may be a better moniker than the American system, since I hope to show the principles are not limited to America. It's never a bad idea to situate yourself in the future when contemplating policy for the present. Suppose we were to say that in 30 years, the world should be linked by an international network of maglev trains, and new modern nuclear power plants should be built to power this network. Many of us here today would agree that this is exactly the kind of policy needed today, and would call it a good example of Hamiltonian policy. But why? Upon what principle does the wisdom of this policy rest? It's my hope that this analysis of the American system will demonstrate these universal principles. My intention is to produce a series of these discussions on the history of the American system and its universal principles over the next year. This is the first, which I've titled The Roots of the American System. Many of us will be familiar with the works of Alexander Hamilton, and his life and works will be the subject of part two in this series. But where did Hamilton's ideas come from? Was he a singular genius discovering these principles? Or was he the inheritor of these ideas, passed down from generations of humanists before him? I hope to demonstrate today that the latter is the case. When I first began working on this examination of the American system, my plan for this first class was to start with Hamilton and do an in-depth review of his writings, his policies, and the principles that they rested on. Being a student of history, I wanted to investigate Hamilton's predecessors and give some historical background in the talk. But the more I delved into the topic, the deeper the rabbit hole went, until eventually I had to ask Matt to allow me to exclude Hamilton from the first topic because there was just too much to cover with his predecessors. The problem one finds when exploring this topic is that for every predecessor, you will also find that they have one or more predecessors to explore, seemingly ad infinitum. For this reason, I made the decision to start at the Great Colbert, as Hamilton called him, because he's, in my opinion, the first great leader to reform his country around these principles in the early modern era. But much of this goes back even further to people like Jean Baudin, Antonio Serra, Thomas Aquinas, Nicholas Accusa, all the way back to Plato. Alexander Hamilton called him the Great Colbert because that is what the French call him. Le Grand Colbert was born in 1619 to a family of merchants. Not a lot is known of his early life for certain. He's from Reims, France, and he may have spent his early youth at a Jesuit college. Before he turned 20, he obtained a post in the War Office through a family. So he was instrumental in establishing the principles of the Peace of Westphalia in 1648. Louis XIV's trust in Colbert grew while Mazarin was in exile following the end of the Fronde, or the French Civil War, that took place between 1648 and 1653, in which the king and Mazarin were able to consolidate the power of the state around the king, rather than the princes and nobility under the old feudal system. This foreshadowed the battle against the old feudalist remnants in France that Colbert would continue to fight. In Mazarin's absence, Colbert remained loyal to the interests of the cardinal and to the king, and his service to the king during this time helped him gain the trust of the king. We see great consistency in Colbert's actions and intentions in this period of the 1650s before Mazarin's death and after 1661 when Mazarin passes. Colbert sent a memo to Mazarin on the topic of tax reform, showing that of the taxes paid by the people of France, only half reached the treasury, and that the nobility were largely of the belief that they were above paying taxes. He also attacked the corrupt minister Fouquet, the superintendent of finances, asserting that he was enriching himself at the expense of the state. Indeed, Mr. Fouquet was quickly becoming the richest man in France, building himself palaces that rivaled the king's. Towards the end of his life, Mazarin came to side with Colbert that Fouquet had to be removed. But as he was the one responsible for hiring Fouquet in 1653, and as he was at the end of his life, that responsibility passed to Colbert in 1661. Upon the death of Mazarin, Colbert moved quickly to gain the king's favor by showing him where Mazarin had hidden some of his wealth. The king was only 23 years old in 1661. Before Mazarin's death, Mazarin was the de facto ruler of France. Now the king would attempt to assume control over France, but he would wisely employ a number of competent advisors, with Colbert chief among them. For this next section on Colbert, I have to give thanks to Anton Chaikin for his paper, Colbert's Bequest to the Founding Fathers. Research in this time of COVID-19 has been very difficult since most libraries are closed. I intend to continue my research on Colbert once the libraries reopen. For example, I'm anxious to study the correspondence of Colbert and read more about him from native French writers. But for now, this article Anton wrote was of enormous help for this section, and I will borrow from it extensively. Colbert moved to immediately open investigation of the superintendent of finance, Nicolas Fouquet, who had long served as an intermediary for the blackmail of the international and regional bankers against the king. They might loan money to the king according to their unpredictable conditions, but he was treated as an individual and was subjected to fraud. There was no French sovereignty. Colbert proved the corruption and treason of Fouquet and of many bankers with whom he had worked. Fouquet's faction had actually planned a violent takeover by the aristocrats. Fouquet was imprisoned and a debt moratorium was declared, freeing the young king from 3 or 4 years of debt strangulation. Colbert then continued to wage all-out political war against the corrupt French nobility. Colbert introduced more efficient taxation, which included aid and douane, so both customs and duties, a tax on salt and a tax on land. The major challenge was that the rich used the outdated tax clauses to pay the least tax. Although this problem was not entirely solved, false claims for exemption were denied and there was an increase in indirect taxes from which the privileged could not escape. The revenue from indirect taxation progressed from 26 million in 1661 to 55 million 4 years later. France had no significant manufacturing capability. Dutch merchants financed by the old Venetian nobility carried most of the world's commerce in their ships. The Dutch trade cartel bought masses of commodities, stored them in their warehouses, and then dumped them at will into French and other markets. The French home industry was constantly undercut. Colbert imposed tariffs on imported goods, but lifted the tolls and taxes which the local aristocracy had imposed on road and river shipments within France, which had made Frenchmen foreigners to one another. A great canal was cut, the Canal du Midi, linking the Atlantic Ocean and the Mediterranean Sea. The building of this canal was an old idea. Leaders such as Augustus, Nero, Charlemagne, Francois I, Charles IX, and Henry IV had dreamed of it. King Francois I brought Leonardo da Vinci to France in 1516 and commissioned a survey of a route from the Garonne at Toulouse to the Aude at Carcassonne. The construction of such a structure would save vessels from sailing around the Iberian Peninsula, which could take a month to complete. At that time, shipping was fraught with dangers such as the Barbary pirates. By bypassing the Strait of Gibraltar, which was controlled by Spain, France was able to simultaneously ensure safer passage of its goods, diminish the power of the Spanish king, and develop their own internal territory, especially the underdeveloped region of Languedoc, which Colbert was eager to develop due to its abundant resources in wheat, wine, wool, silk, and salt. The construction of the canal employed some 12,000 workers for 15 years. In supervising the construction and improvement of roads and waterways, Colbert asked his builders to make their works so good that they would last eternally. Under Chief Engineer Sébastien Vauban, fortresses were constructed by the latest standards, defining and protecting France's frontier. The forts called forth for their supply the construction of new highways and canals. The government started factories and pushed private entrepreneurs to take them over or to build their own. Royal grants were provided for private enterprise, credit from moneylenders, which otherwise circled endlessly through speculation, was encouraged to go to new productive enterprises. Teachers and craftsmen, Protestant and Catholic, were brought in from all of Europe to tutor France's development and help it manage its new factories. Colbert and Louis XIV implemented a wide range of plans to increase commerce and trade. New industries were established, and there was an encouragement to manufacturers and inventors, such as the Lyon silk manufacturers. Manufacturers and artisans were invited from all over Europe and France, such as Murano glassmakers and Swedish ironworkers. This increased French exports while decreasing foreign imports and the outflow of precious metals. With these measures and improved taxation, the deficit of 1661 was turned into a surplus by 1666. When Louis XIV started his personal rule, France was a patchwork of legal systems with many different legal customs. Louis and Colbert introduced a series of legal reforms known as the Code Louis to establish uniform laws throughout France. Civil law was reformed in 1667, criminal law was reformed in 1670, a maritime code was introduced in 1672, and a commercial code in 1673. The French nobility had initiated 11 civil wars in 40 years. King Louis XIV lured them into his lavish court, where he diminished their powers by involving them in leisure activities and making their destinies dependent on him. Remote provinces in France had developed a culture of governing themselves. Louis used intendants or administrative officers to establish royal power in the provinces. He increased their number and functions and used them to reform regional financial, judicial, and legal systems. Intendants reported to the center and carried out its orders in the provinces. By diminishing the power of the nobility and eliminating feudalism, Louis XIV transformed France into a centralized state and became one of the most powerful monarchs in Europe. Far from wishing to build up a vast state bureaucracy, Colbert pointed to the masses of idlers and parasites whose gradual absorption into the workforce would solve France's economic problems. In a memorandum to the king dated October 22, 1664, Colbert explained that the glory of the king would be established by taking action in proportion to great objectives. It is necessary to reduce the professions of your subjects as much as possible to those which can be useful to these grand designs. These are agriculture, merchandise, meaning production and distribution of goods, soldiers and sailors. Your Majesty should be working at the same time to diminish the number of monks and nuns, and the two professions which consume 100,000 of your subjects uselessly and without contributing to your glory are financiers and lawyers. His memorandum on the Reformation of Justice of May 15, 1665 renewed this appeal. Colbert's promotion of home industry and boosting exports over imports has been mislabeled mercantilism by historical writers, the most notoriously fraudulent of whom was Adam Smith. But unlike Adam Smith's concocted mercantilists, Colbert sought not simply to pile up gold and silver in France, but to develop a national culture of technology and trade, which would lift France out of the mire of localist ignorance. The natural consequence of this policy is an improved balance of trade, which fraudulent economists call mercantilism. But insisting that this was the sole aim of his policies is akin to mistaking the shadows on the wall of Plato's cave for reality. His policy for Canada, though ultimately stymied, was similar to that of the English colonists in America and in striking contrast to imperialism. He sought to populate Canada with settlers, to concentrate at first in the East in new cities and modern farms, and to intermarry with the American Indians. He recruited and sent women to marry the French soldiers, les filles du roi, which were already in Canada, hoping to spur rapid population growth. And above all, Colbert opposed the merchant oligarchy in the fur trade, which deliberately kept settlers away or spread them thinly in the wilds, where they intoxicated and looted the Indians. In 1661, an English youth named William Penn was thrown out of Oxford University, having been caught participating in an underground Republican study group. Penn's father, an admiral, sent him to France to study. There, young William spent 2 years watching and perhaps taking part in Colbert's life and death struggle with the aristocracy. And in 1683, the year of Colbert's death, Penn founded the city of Philadelphia. In 1666, Colbert organized the French Academy of Sciences. He brought in the Dutch astronomer Christian Huygens as the Academy's president. The scientists working and studying under Colbert's sponsorship formed the core of leadership in the development of mathematics, physics, and chemistry for the next three centuries. This development, the founding of the French Academy of Sciences, leads us nicely into an examination of the life of our second figure today, Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz. It's no exaggeration to say that Leibniz is one of the most important figures in modern history. He was one of those rare universal geniuses, a polymath of exceptional talent who made lasting contributions to fields as diverse as law, economics, physics, metaphysics, philosophy, and mathematics. A full examination of the life and works of Leibniz would probably take up 10 presentations like this, such as the depth of his life's work. Because we are focusing here on the roots of the American system, I will restrict the conversation mostly to this aspect of his work. But as we will see, there's still a vast amount of contributions to go over, both by Leibniz himself, his collaborators, and his successors. Before we begin an examination of the contributions of Leibniz, we must understand some of the difficulties involved in studying Leibniz. As previously stated, Leibniz was a universal genius, making contributions to a vast number of disciplines. Leibniz spent the majority of his time on his vast correspondence and submissions to learned journals. Because of this, there are relatively few complete and finished works by Leibniz on any given topic, but especially on the topics pertinent to our discussion today. Rather, the study of Leibniz involves the study of thousands of letters, notes, essays, and other snippets accumulated by Leibniz over the years. This is further complicated by the fact that after Leibniz's death, his works were actively suppressed for decades by the Hanoverian kings of Britain, the same dynasty which had employed Leibniz for the last decades of his life. This was so detrimental to the study of Leibniz that as of the time of this presentation in 2020, we still do not have a full public archive of the works of Leibniz. Although thankfully, work is progressing on this front at the Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz Bibliothek in Hanover. I should briefly say that I'm indebted to the biography of Leibniz by Maria Rosa Antognazza, which I will sometimes refer to in this section. Briefly on Leibniz's early life, I will say that Leibniz provides one of the best historical arguments for why children should be raised with a classical education. Leibniz was born in Leipzig, Saxony, in 1646, 2 years before the Peace of Westphalia would take effect. He was baptized a Lutheran and remained a Lutheran his entire life, although the unity of the Christian world, Protestant, Catholic, and Orthodox, was of primary importance to Leibniz his entire life, no doubt influenced by the 30 Years' War, in which religious differences between Christians had led to unprecedented death and destruction on the European continent, which only ended with the Peace of Westphalia. Leibniz's father was a professor of moral philosophy at the University of Leipzig, a well-read scholar who died when Leibniz was 6 years old. From the age of seven, Leibniz was given full access to his father's personal library, an exceedingly rare privilege in those days, allowing him to become proficient in Latin by the age of 12, as well as exposing him to advanced philosophical works at a young age. Much of Leibniz's genius can be attributed to this fact, and it goes to show the effect that a classical education can have on a young mind. He enrolled in his father's university in 1661 at the age of 14. completed his bachelor's degree the following year, his master's degree in philosophy in 1664, his bachelor's degree in law in 1665, his doctorate of philosophy in March of 1666, all from the University of Leipzig. He then applied to do his doctorate in law, but the university considered him too young and his request was denied. He applied at the newly created University of Altdorf and almost immediately submitted his thesis, which he had been working on earlier in Leipzig. He successfully defended his thesis and obtained his doctorate of law in November 1666. The University of Altdorf was so impressed by him that they offered him a professorship, but he turned it down, his ardent desire being to earn more glory in the sciences. He had been born into such a fragmented world of religious and political divisions that he decided that his life's work was to achieve a universal synthesis for the glory of God and the happiness of mankind, designed to achieve unity in multiplicity, unveiling the universal harmony which governed reality at both the metaphysical and epistemological level. Subsequent to this, he met his first great patron, Johann Christian von Boehmenberg, who had recently been dismissed by the Elector of Mainz, Johann Philipp von Schönberg. Von Boehmenberg hired Leibniz as his assistant, and shortly afterwards, von Boehmenberg restored his amicable relationship with the Elector of Mainz and introduced him to Leibniz. The Elector brought Leibniz into his court in 1667, hiring him to help redraft the legal code for the electorate. Von Boehmenberg would pass in 1672, and Leibniz remained in the employ of his widow until 1674. As an aside, the name Schönbornzeit is sometimes given to the era of 1642 to 1756, as it is nostalgically remembered in the popular conscience as an era of prosperity. And Johann Philipp was the first of six members of the Schönborn family who, in the course of more than three generations, went on to rule eight of the most prestigious principalities of the Holy Roman Empire. And his contemporaries gave him the honorable titles the Wise, the German Solomon, and the Cato of Germany. Did Leibniz's work on juridical reform have anything to do with this prosperity? It would be an interesting investigation, but unfortunately outside the scope for this one. Quoting Antognazza, it was during this time period that Leibniz gave more definite form to his early philosophical and scientific aspirations, conceiving an all-embracing plan of reform and advancement of the whole encyclopedia of the sciences intended to celebrate the glory of God through the improvement of the human condition. It's during this time period that the paths of Leibniz and Colbert would cross in Paris. Leibniz went to Paris in 1672, but his motivations for doing so are not entirely clear. Ostensibly, he was there on a diplomatic mission with von Boehmenberg to discuss a plan with King Louis XIV of France to avoid war between France and the Netherlands. When Leibniz arrived in Paris, his plan was already moot because perfidious Albion had abandoned their Dutch ally and started a war with Holland, which France joined on April 6, 1672. Leibniz made no moves to modify his plan upon arriving in Paris following this setback, and he would remain in Paris for 4 years. What we know for certain is that earlier in 1671, Leibniz was showing tremendous interest in visiting France. He was in contact with several French luminaries close to Colbert, including Pierre de Carcavie, who was hired by Colbert in 1663 as custodian of the Royal Library. He was also in contact with a young Orientalist he had met in Mainz years earlier, whom Colbert had brought to Paris, Louis Ferrin, who would stoke a deep interest in Leibniz about Chinese culture and philosophy. Leibniz dedicated his Hypothesis Physica Nova in 1671 to the British Royal Society, and the companion piece Theoria Motus Abstracti to the French Academy of Sciences. He also wrote two pieces, no doubt inspired by the works of Colbert in France, and which are highly pertinent to our topic today. The first is a short piece called Society and Economy. It's only an outline, as admitted by Leibniz at the end, saying, "Let this, even though uncompleted, be published as a beginning." but its lineage as an ancestor of Hamilton's thought is unmistakable. Here are some excerpts. This is the very first sentence. Can I get a volunteer to read?
I can read. Monopoly is avoided since this society always desires to give commodities at their fair price or even more cheaply in many cases by causing manufactured goods to be produced locally rather than having them imported.
So that's the very first sentence.
It will especially preclude the formation of any monopoly of merchants or a cartel of artisans, along with any excessive accumulation of wealth by the merchants or excessive poverty of the artisans, which is particularly the case in Holland, where the majority of merchants are riding high, whereas the artisans are kept in continual poverty and toil. This is harmful to the Republic, since even Aristotle maintains that artisanship ought to be one of the worthiest occupations.
So Leibniz divides labor into three camps: farmers, merchants, and artisans, meaning skilled craftsmen and manufacturers.
And why indeed should so many people be poor and miserable for the benefit of such a small handful? After all, is not the entire purpose of society to release the artisan from his misery? Should money be invested in other countries? By no means. Each country shall, on the contrary, supply itself with those necessary commodities and manufactured goods which previously came from abroad, so that it will not have to procure from others what it can have for itself. Each country shall be shown how properly to use its own domestic resources. The education of children will be taken care of by society. Parents shall be relieved of the task of educating their own children. All children, while they are small, shall be rigorously brought up by women in public facilities, and scrupulous attention will be paid that they do not become overcrowded, are kept clean, and that no diseases arise. How could anyone live more happily than that? Artisans will work together happily in the company's large rooms, singing and conversing, except for those whose work requires more concentration.
The second work Leibniz wrote during this time was encouraging the development of a German Academy of Sciences, precisely as Colbert had done in France. Titled On the Establishment of a Society in Germany for the Promotion of the Arts and Sciences, he developed several important themes that we will continue to encounter in this series. To briefly sum up the paper, Leibniz wrote that the glory of God is evident in our ability to reason, and that using our ability to reason in pursuit of science is to revere the glory of God. As Antognazza put it, the advancement of science was undertaken for the glory of God, which also coincided with the general good. The work is divided into 26 paragraphs. Here are some key excerpts. Paragraph 8. Gerald, you want to read?
Okay. The knowledge of the divine nature is naturally to be derived out of nothing other than the true demonstration of his existence. Such must principally be taken from the fact that it is not possible without him to furnish a reason, and yet nothing is without a reason. Why, things which might not exist really do exist. And further, why things which could be confused and chaotic are in such a beautiful, inexpressible harmony. The former establishes that he must be the ultimate reason of things and therefore the highest power. The latter, that he must be the ultimate harmony of things and thus the greatest wisdom. You want me to keep going?
Yeah, there's a few more excerpts. Number 18.
From this it follows inexorably that charity, the love of God above all, and true contrition, on which the assurance of blessedness depends, is nothing other than that love of the public good and of universal harmony. Or rather, on that account, the glory of God and to understand are the same, and how great it is in itself to make greater. For there is no more distinction between universal harmony and the glory of God than between body and shadow, person and picture, between a direct and reflected ray of light. Since the one is what is in fact, the other what is in the soul of him who knows it. For God creates rational creatures for no other reason but that they should serve as a mirror, in which his infinite harmony would be infinitely multiplied in some respects, from which must arise in due course the completed knowledge and love of God. In the beatific vision or the incomprehensible joy, which the mirroring and to a certain degree the concentrating of the infinite beauty in a small point in our souls must bring with it. And thus, a burning mirror or burning glass is the natural image here. 10. If then the love of God above all, contrition, and eternal beatitude arise from the fact that each comprehends the beauty of God and the universal harmony according to his own rational ability, and reflects it back unto others, and additionally, according to the proportion of his ability, promotes and increases that shining forth in men and other creatures, then it follows from that that all of those to whom the somewhat sparing nature, in order to shade the world with variety, gave a lesser degree of reason and power, so that they must serve others as instruments and means, do enough if they let themselves be used as instruments for the glory of God and, what is the same thing, for the common good. And for the nourishment, ease of labor, comfort, instruction, and enlightenment of their fellow man, for discovery, research, and improvement of creatures according to the limitations of ability and knowledge. Thus, they satisfy their conscience. All right. 15. And among philosophers, those honor God who discover a new harmony in nature and art, and thus make his omnipotence and wisdom visible. Thus, Moses, Job, David, and others were accustomed, for the most part, to take the material for their songs of praise from the natural wonders which God implanted in creation, as much as from that which he had done for the salvation of his people, how he set limits to the sea, arched over the heavens, traveled far above the clouds, sounding his thunder, giving rise to rivers, growing plants, and having the animals find at the proper time their nourishment and food. 17. And therefore, I am of the opinion that even the great moralists and politicians, who are not, however, naturalists, and who are neither conversant with nor pay attention to the wonders of nature, are missing a great part of the proper awe, the true knowledge, and the devout love of God, and thus the perfection of their souls, to the point that their art of knowing and ruling men is not made good through excellent science and good practices. Therefore, no one can praise God with more zeal and greater energy than he who with his eloquence and poetry, and also in true philosophy, goes beyond the boundaries of common knowledge. 22. These are the ones who apply the discovered wonders of nature and art to medicine, to mechanics, to the comfort of life, to materials for work and sustenance of the poor, to keeping people from idleness and vice, to the operation of justice and to reward and punishment, to preservation of the common peace, to the increase and welfare of the fatherland, to the elimination of times of shortage, disease, and war, insofar as it is in our power and is our responsibility, to the propagation of true religion and fear of God, indeed, to the happiness of the human race, and who endeavor to imitate in their domain what God has done in the world. Among such means, one of the easiest and most important will be the establishment of a society or academy, well grounded, although small at the start. Through that, the natural genius of the Germans will be inspired, according to the examples of all their neighbors, which is hope they will excel. Means will be supplied to maintain the nourishment of the people, to establish manufacturing and consequently draw in commerce, and in time to establish workhouses and houses of discipline for the idle and criminal in which to work. To improve the schools, furnishing the youth with exercises, languages, and the reality of the sciences before they unfortunately travel, and establish gentlemen's schools as well. To facilitate the crafts through improvements and tools, through always inexpensive fire and motion. To test and be able to work out everything in chemistry and mechanics, to work with glass, to create telescopes, machines, water devices, clocks, lathes, painting studios, presses, paint companies, weaving factories, steel and iron works, and even some quite useful things which, when done in a small way without organization, are unfruitful. To summarize books and manuscripts and posthumous works, to bring together scattered reports, experiments, and letters of correspondence, to have everything in order and indexed. To support poor students and at the same time create institutions for their work, which will be useful both to them and to society.
Thank you, Gerald. As a side note, Leibniz would contribute to the founding of several scientific academies in his lifetime, such as the Prussian Academy of Sciences, the Vienna Academy of Sciences, and the St. Petersburg Academy. In 1712, Leibniz wrote to the Russian Chancellor Govolkin, stating that from his youth onward, he had aimed at contributing to the glory of God through the advancement of the sciences. In the same year, he wrote to Tsar Peter the Great, "Although I have very frequently been employed in public affairs and also in the judiciary system, and am consulted on such matters by great princes on an ongoing basis, I nevertheless regard the arts and sciences as a higher calling, since through them the glory of God and the best interests of the whole of the human race is continuously promoted. For in the sciences and the knowledge of nature and art, the wonders of God, his power, wisdom, and goodness are especially manifest, and the arts and sciences are also the true treasury of the human race, through which art masters nature and civilized people are distinguished from the barbarian ones. For these reasons, I have loved and pursued science since my youth. The one thing I have been lacking is a leading prince who adequately embraced this cause. I am not a man devoted solely to his native country. On the contrary, I pursue the interests of the whole human race because I regard heaven as my fatherland and all well-meaning people as its fellow citizens. To this aim, for a long time, I have been conducting a voluminous correspondence in Europe and even as far as China. And for many years, I have not only been a fellow of the French and English Royal Societies, but also direct as president of the Royal Prussian Society of Sciences." Leibniz was then appointed as Russian Privy Councilor of Justice, as well as advisor to the Tsar on mathematical and scientific affairs. Leibniz wrote of his ideal job description to the Tsar, "A minister without portfolio, devoted to the advancement of knowledge, and free to pursue a wide range of reforms and research projects." Returning to Leibniz's attempts to get to Paris, on July 3, 1671, the theologian Johann Leiser wrote Leibniz from Paris, assuring him that Pierre de Carcavi and the mathematician Jean Galois, editor of the prestigious journal Journal des Savants and secretary of the Academy of Sciences, desired nothing more than to benefit at the meetings of the Academy from Leibniz's learning. No later than the fall of 1671, Leibniz began preparing his trip to Paris. He asked Duke Johann Friedrich for a letter of recommendation, citing the encouraging contacts he had already made with Colbert, Carcavi, and Ferrand. Leibniz was in Paris for 4 years, and there are many great things he accomplished during his time that are worthy of discussion. He invented calculus in Paris, thanks to the mentorship of Christian Huygens in mathematics. He perfected his calculating machine, which he demonstrated to Colbert, who ordered three of them. He even found time to travel to England and was made a member of the Royal Society. But here we will focus on the work he did with Christian Huygens and Denis Papin on the use of heat-powered machinery. There's a great article online from Philip Valenti titled Leibniz, Papin, and the Steam Engine, to which I am heavily indebted for this section. Leibniz wrote to Duke Johann Friedrich in January 1675, Paris is a place where one can achieve distinction only with difficulty. One finds there in all branches of knowledge the most knowledgeable men of the age. And one of the luminaries he met was Christian Huygens, the director of the French Academy of Sciences. Huygens proposed a series of research programs when he was made director in 1666, including research into the power of gunpowder, of which a small portion is enclosed in a very thick iron or copper case, and research into the power of water converted by fire into steam. In 1672, when Leibniz came to Paris, Huygens, Papin, and Leibniz began working on this problem. Papin and Leibniz would continue to collaborate on this project for the rest of their lives. Contrary to the lie put out by British historians that the Industrial Revolution happened by accident when water pumps used in coal mines were applied to human labor generally, Leibniz, Papin, and Huygens pursued this from the beginning as a method of increasing the productive powers of labor. Huygens wrote on the results of their work with gunpowder. The violent action of the powder is by this discovery restricted to a movement which limits itself as does that of a great weight. And not only can it serve all purposes to which weight is applied, but also in most cases where man or animal power is needed. By this means permits the discovery of new kinds of vehicles on land and water. And although it may sound contradictory, it seems not impossible to devise some vehicle to move through the air. So not only were they planning improvements to human labor, they had already conceived of powered transportation and even conceptualized the airplane. Such is the power of this mode of thinking. Continuing his lifelong project, Papin wrote to Leibniz in 1705. Scott, you available to read?
Sure, yeah.
Okay.
This one here?
Yeah.
All right. The more I go forward, the more I wonder how a small quantity of wood is capable of furnishing such force. But it would be desirable to work at that with more heat than made now, seeing principally that the use of this invention isn't limited to raising water, but that it could be applied very well to vehicles and to many other things where force is needed.
The reply of Leibniz demonstrates another British lie about James Watt and the development of the steam engine. Leibniz wrote back, go ahead, Scott.
I'm delighted that your fire engine advances so well, because when it is brought to perfection, consider that it will be very useful. I consider it will be very useful. Also, it would be a mere triple if only one third of the expense would be saved. As the English author, Savory, believed, since this advantage would be easily absorbed by other inconveniences which such a great alteration of machines would attract, it is very reasonable also to believe that too diffuse, steam applied directly to cold water will condense and lose its force. Consequently, it is better kept, is better to keep them self-contained.
According to British historians, this innovation of keeping the cold condenser separate was only imagined by James Watt in 1769, 64 years after Papin and Leibniz had already conceived of it. In the same year, 1705, Papin demonstrated again their commitment to increasing the productive power of labor when he wrote to Leibniz. Hold on, Scott, you're muted. I'll read this one. I can assure you that the more I go forward, the more I find reason to think highly of this invention, which in theory may augment the powers of man to infinity. But in practice, I believe I can say without exaggeration that one man by this means will be able to do as much as 100 others can do without it. All that I've done up until now has only been to discover the characteristics of this machine and the different symptoms to which it may be subject. But Monseigneur from now on wants to apply it to some real use, and His Highness gave me the honor of commanding me to apply this force to turn a mill to grind wheat. And if after the mill we can proceed to apply this invention to ships, I would believe this discovery incomparably more useful than finding longitudes on the ocean, which has been sought for so long. In 1707, Papin published his treatise on his new invention, a new method for raising water by the force of fire, where he gives Leibniz full credit in the preface for the aid he gave him in advancing his experiments. This commitment of Leibniz to increase the productive powers of labor was not isolated to his work on Papin, and I have found other instances where he advocated for the benefits of mechanization. In 1676, Leibniz left Paris after being rejected for a post with the French Academy. The atmosphere in France was hostile to foreigners, especially Germans, and given that the foreigners Huygens and Cassini already occupied prominent posts in the Academy, it was deemed, unfortunately, that there was no room for another. Leibniz left Paris for Hanover, beginning his relationship with the House of Hanover, which would last for the rest of his life. In 1687, Leibniz wrote on a discussion d'une question utile et curieuse, or a discussion of a useful and curious question. He describes the point of the article in the introduction. Knowing if it is necessary to allow the introduction of instruments which reduce work, and on the means by which one man can do as much as many men. Leibniz then continues, "The advantages that we gain from these machines are in respect of the country in which they are. The advantage of the human race in general is the increase of its power. The power of someone is increased when they can have greater effect with less toil, less cost, less people, and less time. For example, the machines of Archimedes allow us to lift with the power of one man vast amounts of weight, of which even 100 men together could not lift without the power of this machine. For this reason, the pickers and others who lived from these sorts of large projects opposed Archimedes and objected to the introduction of these machines. But the human race would have greatly lost out if Chiron, king of Sicily, would have listened to them, responding to them that they could apply themselves to tasks of more considerable importance and less prone to mechanization. We did many things long ago in our minds with only human might that is now done by machine. We have introduced the use of cannon powder that does more in one instant than a worker can do in a week. Mine workers are constantly opposed to these sorts of inventions by which work is reduced, thinking that this will render them less useful and will reduce their numbers. But we have not recognized their argument, and their apprehension was ill-founded, when we have now found employment for them doing other tasks. I also found this letter in 1699. Leibniz corresponded with one Cord Plato von Galen on the use of machinery for threshing wheat. Matt, do you want to read?
Yes.
Writing in December.
As for the machine intended to thresh the wheat, I believe that the object is very easy and can very well succeed. Many denigrate these sorts of machines, which save men labor, as if we are stealing bread from the mouths of the poor. This is why in Ratisbonne, a few years back, we defended machines for making ribbons and stockings. Die Strumpf und Bandmühlen. But besides this, the defense has had no effect. I find that we can always find useful work for men. And if there are some who are inconvenienced, it is only at the beginning, when people are not yet accustomed to doing other tasks. In Asia and in Provence and Spain, they use animals who tread on the wheat to get the grain out. We could also do this with machines without robbing men of their jobs.
So now, as we move on to the final part of this presentation, the work of Vattel, we will examine some of Leibniz's work on natural law, which became the basis for Vattel's magnum opus. Leibniz's work on natural law was founded on human reason, which we have already seen to him was evidence of the glory of God, and that to contribute to the glory of God as a rational creature, man had to promote the general welfare, or as he put it, the common good. His work is replete with examples advocating this. In 1669, he wrote of creating a Societas Philadelphica, the proposed aim of which was the promotion of the utility of humankind, above all by means of medicine. It was intended to span political and religious division. As Leibniz argued, the collaborative work of a society would bear infinitely more fruit than the isolated efforts of individuals or even individual nations. Leibniz believed of good health that only virtue was more excellent, and that health and decent social conditions contributed more to the happiness of mankind than pure philosophy. He pushed for properly regulated state support of medicine. As human life is a sacred thing, it should never be subject to the marketplace. Plato is the father of natural law theory, and Leibniz was an avowed Platonist, becoming familiar with his writings at an early age. Leibniz stated that were Plato's philosophy to be stated rigorously and systematically, it would come quite close to his own. While in Paris, he produced abridgments in Latin of Phaedo, Parmenides, and Theaetetus, apparently for the use of the Dauphin. His regard for Plato was probably greater than for any other philosopher. He referred to Plato as the greatest of the idealists, that is, those opposed to the materialism of Aristotle. He accepted a Christianized version of the theory of forms in which the eternal ideas exist in God's mind, borrowing heavily from the works of St. Augustine, who Leibniz also greatly admired. Plato is the cornerstone for Leibniz's ideas on innate ideas, which he contrasted with John Locke's tabula rasa theory, and for eternal truths, which form the basis of natural law theory, and which were his biggest point of contention with other natural law theorists, such as Grotius, Hobbes, and Pufendorf. Leibniz studied Pufendorf's massive work, De jure natura et gentium, in the winter of 1675 to 76. Quoting now from the book by Antognazza. Judged from their external circumstances of their careers, Pufendorf and Leibniz had a great deal in common. Both were Lutherans, both Saxons, both alumni of the universities of Leipzig and Jena, both philosophers of politics and law, both later court historians, respectively in Berlin and Hanover. The commonalities, however, ended more or less there. From a doctrinal standpoint, there was very little Leibniz approved of in Pufendorf's voluntaristic political and juridical philosophy, and throughout his life, he took a very critical stance toward his fellow countrymen, stating from his first critical appraisal in Mainz of Pufendorf's Disquisitio de Republica Irregulari. Although at some point during 1674, Leibniz wrote to Pufendorf and a few letters were exchanged between 1690 and 1693, a substantial correspondence between the two never developed. The two most important followers of Pufendorf are Barbarac, who attacks Leibniz and, as we will see, is in turn attacked by Vattel, and John Locke, whose work Leibniz opposed his whole life. Leibniz's attacks on Pufendorf, as well as Descartes and Thomas Hobbes, centered around their advocacy of voluntarism, in which something is good simply because God wills it, as he wrote in his discourse on metaphysics. If we say things are good by no rule of goodness beyond the will of God alone, we thoughtlessly destroy all the love and glory of God. For why praise him for what he has done if he would be equally praiseworthy for doing the opposite? Where will his justice and his wisdom be if all that remains of him is some kind of despotic power, if his will takes the place of reason, and if by the very definition of tyranny, what pleases the Almighty is ipso facto just? Taken again from the book by Antagonatza on natural law and Pufendorf. The abbot of Lucem asked Leibniz whether Pufendorf's De officio hominis e civis juxta legem naturalem was suitable as a topic of instruction for the young. Leibniz replied that Pufendorf's little book could serve usefully as a compendium of natural law for those who are satisfied with a superficial smattering without looking for sound learning, since the author seemed to have correctly identified neither the end, the object, nor the efficient cause of natural law. Oops, I was supposed to. In short, Leibniz could scarcely have disagreed more with the legal positivism and voluntarism of Pufendorf, Hobbes, and the like. Indeed, Leibniz continued, a doctrine which makes all law derivative from the command of a superior is not free of scandals and errors, even if the superior in question is God. Neither the norm of conduct itself nor the essence of the just depends on God's free decision, but rather on eternal truths, objects of the divine intellect, which constitute, so to speak, the essence of divinity itself. Leibniz wrote on most subjects in brief articles and essays spread over the decades, and his work on natural law was no different. As we shall see, one of Vattel's main contributions was to gather, clarify, and systematize the work of Leibniz on natural law in vernacular French rather than Latin. Leibniz wrote De jure suprematum in 1676 for his new employer, the Elector of Hanover. And in 1693, he wrote the Codex Juris Gentium Diplomaticus. But his greatest work on the subject was his Méditation sur la notion commune de justice. I have tried very hard to find the actual work so we could study it in Leibniz's own words, but it has proven very difficult to find. And so for now, we will examine some of what others have written on it. Unfortunately, after the deaths of his first Hanoverian benefactor, Johann Friedrich, the next two would have worsening relations with Leibniz. He did, however, have excellent relationships with Sophia of the Palatinate, wife of his second Hanoverian benefactor, Ernest Augustus, and their daughter, Sophie Charlotte. Quoting here from Antognatza, Kevin, are you available to read? I can't see you, but are you there? Okay.
Just ask someone to jump in.
Okay, anybody just jump in if you want to read.
I'll jump in.
Go ahead, Dave.
Oh, okay. All right. On Méditation sur la notion commune de la justice. In a letter to Sophie Charlotte on August 5th, 1703, Leibniz wrote, having had a conversation with the elector in the presence of the electress on the nature of goodness and justice, whether it is an arbitrary thing or whether it is grounded in eternal reasons, as numbers and figures are, I wrote a little discourse about it, and I do not know whether I will dare someday to show these bagatelles to your majesty. Since George Ludwig was no philosopher, the real convener of this discussion was in all likelihood Sophie. Its fruit was the Méditation sur la notion commune de la justice, perhaps Leibniz's most important and extensive writing on the notion of justice as charity of the wise and universal benevolence. Organized in two parts of strongly Platonic inspiration, the meditation was left unpublished. In it, Leibniz took a firm stand against voluntarism, defended in various ways by some of his favorite critical targets, Descartes, Pufendorf, and Hobbes. Repeating almost verbatim Plato's celebrated Euthyphro dilemma, he opened the meditation with the vexed question of whether there is an objective standard of goodness and justice. It is agreed that whatever God wills is good and just, but there remains the question of whether it is good and just because God wills it, or whether God wills it because it is good and just. In other words, whether justice and goodness are arbitrary, or whether they belong to the necessary and eternal truths about the nature of things, as do numbers and proportions. Following Plato, Leibniz's answer sees the second horn of this dilemma. Justice and goodness belong to eternal truths about the nature of things, which as such have the same kind of absolute necessity as the truths of logic and mathematics. Divine justice and human justice must therefore be of the same kind, differing from one another only in degree of perfection. As for the notion of justice itself, Leibniz claimed, justice is nothing else than the charity of the wise, that is to say, goodness toward others, which is conformed to wisdom. In turn, wisdom is nothing else than that science of felicity.
In the meditation, Leibniz defines natural law, or the science of right, as one of the sciences of eternal truths. In part two of the meditation, Leibniz distinguishes between different degrees of justice, and it contains a refutation of the arguments put forth in defense of slavery, which was far ahead of its time. The right of property is based upon what he calls jus strictum, and in this narrow sense, parents may have rights over their own children and slave owners over the slaves they have bought. But in a larger view, all souls have rights as members of the city of God that override the pretended absolute rights of parents and slave owners. As rational souls, they are naturally and inalienably free, a sentiment strongly echoed in the American Revolution to come seven decades later under the influence of Leibniz and his successors. Before we move on to Emerich de Vattel, we will speak briefly about the other main influence on Vattel besides Leibniz, Christian Wolff. He was a contemporary and ally of Leibniz who wrote prolifically, mainly on economics and public administration. Wolff first reached out to Leibniz in 1704, asking for his comments on his dissertation, which Leibniz greatly enjoyed. And he and Schoenhaus supported his appointment as a professor of mathematics at the University of Halle. A center of learning, which we will see in the next part of this series, was an important extension of Leibniz's world, centered as it was in Hanover. Towards the end of Leibniz's life, he becomes one of his top defenders in the calculus controversy with Newton. After Leibniz's death, he becomes one of Leibniz's biggest proponents and one of the first to try and systematize his writings and philosophical outlook. This was not without controversy, as other Leibniz supporters accused him of what we would call watering down Leibniz, expressing a simplistic version of his philosophy without true understanding. Vattel would write Law of Nations to try and synthesize the writings of both Leibniz and Wolff into a systematic and coherent form, although, as we will see, he did take issue with some of Wolff's work. So, on to Emerich de Vattel. Vattel was Swiss, and he went to Geneva in 1733 to study natural law under Jean-Jacques Burlamaqui, who is unknown today, but in his day was extremely popular and best-selling author on the topic of natural law, especially with several of the founding fathers. Burlamaqui was a Platonist who tread the course between Leibniz and Pufendorf on natural law, leaning slightly more towards the Leibnizian view. He was the first to articulate the pursuit of happiness as a right under natural law. He also did excellent work on the separation of powers, which the founding fathers leaned on heavily. Following his natural law studies, Vattel became a dedicated Leibnizian. His first publication was called A Defense of the Leibnizian System, against the accusations of Jean-Pierre de Cruzaz, an admirer of Descartes and John Locke. Vattel eventually made his way back to his birthplace of Neuchâtel in Switzerland in the employ of Count Brühl, first minister of the elector Friedrich August II of Saxony. Here he would remain for over 10 years, with ample spare time for writing essays and studying the works of Leibniz and Wolff. What became the Law of Nations began as a translation of Wolff's Jus Gentium Methodico Scientifica Pertractum from the original Latin into French, adding his own thoughts. He explicitly attacks Aristotle, Grotius, and Pufendorf. Grotius had attempted to use Aristotle to justify slavery, writing, "Further, as Aristotle said that some men are by nature slaves, that is, are suited to slavery, so there are some people so constituted that they understand better how to be ruled than to rule." Vattel attacked Hobbes's assertion that war is the natural state of man. According to Vattel, the natural state of man is reason, and it is part of a rational being to terminate his differences through rational methods, whereas it is the characteristic of the brute creation to decide theirs by force. Besides the Law of Nations, Vattel also published three essays on natural law, one of which took on Barbarac, Pufendorf, and Grotius in defense of Leibniz. That essay, called Essay on the Foundation of Natural Law and on the First Principle of the Obligation Men Find Themselves Under to Obey, to Observe Laws, is also very useful in terms of defining Leibniz and Vattel's conception of natural law as innate and eternal truths, which we come to know through reason, rather than the whims of a superior, which must dutifully be obeyed as the voluntarists see it. The full name is the Law of Nations, or Principles of the Law of Nature Applied to the Conduct and Affairs of Nations and Sovereigns. It is an epic work, and I highly encourage everyone to read it. In the interest of time today, we will examine some key excerpts which demonstrate Vattel's influence on the development of the American system. It's composed of four books. Book one, Of Nations Considered in Themselves. Book two, Of a Nation Considered in Its Relations to Others. Book three, Of War. And book four, Of the Restoration of Peace and of Embassies. Just take a look at some of the section titles to get a sense of how the Founding Fathers would have found this book useful. In Book 1, Chapter 3, Of the Constitution of a State and the Duties and Rights of the Nation in this Respect. Chapter 6, Principal Objects of Good Government, and First to Provide for the Necessities of the Nation. Chapter 7, Of the Cultivation of the Soil. Chapter 8, Of Commerce. Chapter 9, Of the Care of the Public Ways of Communication and the Right of Toll. Chapter 10, Of Money and Exchange. Chapter 11, The Second Object of Good Government, to Procure the True Happiness of the Nation. Chapter 14, The Third Object of Good Government, to Fortify Itself Against External Attacks. Chapter 17, sorry, I have trouble with Roman numerals. How a nation may separate itself from the state of which it is a member or renounce its allegiance to its sovereign when it is not protected. Chapter 18, on the establishment of a nation in a country. And in book three, of the just causes of war. Chapter 11, of the sovereign who wages an unjust war. And chapter 18, of Civil War. And book 4, chapter 1, of Peace and the Obligation to Cultivate It. The preface introduces some of the issues Vattel has with Wolff's notions on natural law. In the very outset of my work, it will be found that I differ entirely from Monsieur Wolff in the manner of establishing the foundations of that species of law of nations which we call voluntary. Monsieur Wolff deduces it from the idea of a great republic, what he calls civitatis maximae, instituted by nature herself, and of which all the nations of the world are members. According to him, the voluntary law of nations is, as it were, the civil law of that great republic. This idea does not satisfy me, nor do I think the fiction of such a republic either admissible in itself or capable of affording sufficiently solid grounds on which to build the rules of the universal law of nations, which shall necessarily claim the obedient acquiescence of sovereign states. I acknowledge no other natural society between nations than that which nature has established between mankind in general. It is essential to every civil society that each member have resigned a part of its right to the body of the society, and that there exists in it an authority capable of commanding all the members, of giving them laws, and of compelling those who should refuse to obey. Nothing of this kind can be conceived or supposed to subsist between nations. Each sovereign state claims and actually possesses an absolute independence on all the others. So Vattel adamantly stands up for the notion of sovereign nation states, which caused him to be attacked by the promoters of world government following World War I. I need somebody to read here. Quan, are you up for it?
Okay, is it the Law of Nations?
Yeah. So the book opens with a section called the Preliminaries, and this is from Section 10.
Okay. Preliminaries, Section 10. Man is so formed by nature that he cannot supply all his own wants, but necessarily stands in need of the intercourse and assistance of his fellow creatures, whether for his immediate preservation or for the sake of perfecting his nature and enjoying such a life as is suitable to a rational being. This is sufficiently proved by experience. We have instances of persons who, having grown up to manhood among the bears of the forest, enjoy not the use of speech or of reason, but were, like the brute beasts, possessed only of sensitive faculties. We see, moreover, that nature has refused to bestow on man the same strength and natural weapons of defense with which she has furnished other animals, having, in lieu of those advantages, endowed mankind with the faculties of speech and reason, or at least a capability of acquiring them by an intercourse with their fellow creatures. Speech enables them to communicate with each other, to give each other mutual assistance, to perfect their reason and knowledge, and having thus become intelligent, they find a thousand methods of preserving themselves and supplying their wants. Each individual, moreover, is intimately conscious that he can neither live happily nor improve his nature without the intercourse and assistance of others. Since, therefore, nature has thus formed mankind, it is a convincing proof of her intention that they should communicate with and mutually aid and assist each other. Hence is deduced the establishment of natural society among men. The general law that of that society is that each individual should do for the others everything which their necessities require and which he can perform without neglecting the duty that he owes to himself. A law which all men must observe in order to live in a manner consonant to their nature and conformable to the views of their common creator. A law which our own safety, our happiness, our dearest interests ought to render sacred to every one of us. Such is the general obligation that binds us to the observance of our duties. Let us fulfill them with care if we would wisely endeavor to promote our own advantage.
And here in this next section, we see an explicit attack on the Hobbesian war of all against all?
It is easy to conceive what exalted felicity the world would enjoy were all men willing to observe the rule that we have just let down. On the contrary, if each man wholly and immediately directs all his thoughts to his own interests, if he does nothing for the sake of other men, the whole human race together will be immersed in the deepest wretchedness. Let us therefore endeavor to promote the general happiness of mankind. All mankind, in return, will endeavor to promote ours, and thus we shall establish our felicity on the most solid foundations.
So now, moving past the preliminaries to book one of Nations Considered in Themselves, anybody want to volunteer to do some readings in book one?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, Pascal. So we'll start at chapter two, General Principles of the Duties of a Nation Towards Itself.
All right, section 15. The end or object of civil society is to procure for the citizens whatever they stand in need of, for the necessities, the conveniences, the accommodation of life, and, in general, whatever constitutes happiness. With the peaceful possession of property, a method of obtaining justice with security, and, finally, a mutual defense against all ignorance. Section 21. All the citizens who form a political society reciprocally engage to advance the common welfare and, as far as possible, to promote the advantage of each member. Since then, the perfection of the society is what enables it to secure equally the happiness of the body and that of the members. The grand object of the engagements and duties of citizen is to aim at this perfection. This is more particularly the duty of the body collective in all their common deliberations and in everything they do as a body. Chapter 3 of the Constitution of a State and the duties and rights of the nation in this respect. Section 28. The perfection of a state and its aptitude to attain the ends of society must then depend on its constitution. Consequently, the most important concern of a nation that forms a political society and its first and most essential duty towards itself is to choose the best constitution possible and that most suitable to its circumstances. When it makes this choice, it lays the foundation of its own preservation, safety, perfection, and happiness. It cannot take too much care in placing these on a solid basis.
Hey, Sam?
Yeah.
What year is Emerich de Vattel publishing this? Like, oh, yeah.
1758.
Huh, okay.
All right. Chapter 4. Of the sovereign, his obligations and his rights. Section 39. A good prince, a wise conductor of society, ought to have his mind impressed with this great truth, that the sovereign power is solely entrusted to him for the safety of the state and the happiness of all the people, that he is not permitted to consider himself as the principal object in the administration of affairs, to seek his own satisfaction or his private advantage, but that he ought to direct all his views, all his steps, to the greatest advantage of the state and people who have submitted to him. Section 42. All that has been said in Chapter 2 of the general duties of a nation towards itself clearly regards the sovereign. He is the depositary of the empire and of the power of commending whatever conduces to the public welfare. He ought, therefore, as a tender and wise father and as a faithful administrator, to watch for the nation and take care to preserve it and render it more perfect, to better its state and to secure it as far as possible against everything that threatens its safety or its happiness.
And here he takes a stand against the absolute right of sovereignty, of the sovereign.
Section 51. They say that an absolute sovereign completely possesses all the political authority of the society, which nobody can oppose. That if he abuses it, he does ill indeed and wounds his conscience, but that his commands are not the less obligatory as being founded on the lawful right to command, that the nation, by giving him absolute authority, has reserved no share of it to itself and has submitted to his discretion, etc. We might be content with answering that in this light, there's not any sovereign who is completely and fully absolute. Let us remember the essential end of civil society. Is it not to labor in concert for the common happiness of all? Was it not with this view that every citizen divested himself of his rights and resigned his liberty? Chapter 6. Principal objects of a good government and first to provide for the necessities of the nation. Section 72. The nation or its conductor should first apply to the business of providing for all the wants of the people and producing a happy plenty of all the necessaries of life with its conveniences and innocent and laudable enjoyments. As an easy life without luxury contributes to the happiness of men, it likewise enables them to labor with greater safety and success after their own perfection, which is their grand and principal duty, and one of the ends they ought to have in view when they unite in society. Section 74. Those workmen that are useful ought to be retained in the state. To succeed in retaining them, the public authority has certainly a right to use constraint. If necessary, every citizen owes his personal services to his country, and a mechanic in particular who has been reared, educated, and instructed in its bosom cannot lawfully leave it. In particular, who has been reared, educated, and instructed in its bosom, cannot lawfully leave it and carry to a foreign land that industry which he acquired at home, unless his country has no occasion for him, or he cannot there obtain the just fruit of his labor and abilities. Employment must then be procured for him. Section 76. The state ought to encourage labor, to animate industry, to excite abilities, to propose honors, rewards, privileges, and so to order matters that everyone may live by his industry. In this particular, England deserves to be held up as an example. The Parliament incessantly attends to these important affairs, in which neither care nor expense is spared. And do we not even see a society of excellent citizens formed with this view and devoting considerable sums to this use? Premiums are also distributed in Ireland to the mechanics who most distinguish themselves in their profession. Can such a state fail of being powerful and happy?
Keep in mind, this is written in the 1750s when England was still a highly protectionist country.
Mm. Yeah, and before they brutalized Ireland and shut down their manufacturing.
Exactly.
Chapter 8 of Commerce.
Are you getting tired, Pascal, or you want to keep going?
No, that's fine.
Okay.
Section 84. The home trade of a nation is of great use. It furnishes all citizens with the means of procuring whatever they want as either necessary, useful, or agreeable. It causes a circulation of money, excites industry, animates labor, and, by affording subsistence to a great number of people, contributes to increase the population and power of the state. Section 86. Nations are obliged to cultivate the home trade. First, because it is clearly demonstrated from the law of nature that mankind ought mutually to assist each other, and, as far as in their power, contribute to the perfection and happiness of their fellow creatures. Whence arises, after the introduction of private property, the obligation to resign to others at a fair price those things which they have occasion for, and which we do not destine for our own use. Secondly, society being established with the view that each may procure whatever things are necessary to his own perfection and happiness, and a home trade being the means of obtaining them, the obligations to carry and improve this trade are derived from the very compact on which the society, finally, being advantageous to the nation, it is a duty the people owe to themselves to make this commerce flourish. Section 90. Every state has consequently a right to prohibit the entrance of foreign merchandises, and the nations that are affected by such prohibition have no right to complain of it, as if they had been refused an office of humanity. Their complaints would be ridiculous, since their only ground of complaint would be that of profit, that a profit is refused to them by that nation, who does not choose they should make it at her expense.
Is anybody hearing anything Hamiltonian in all of this?
Yeah, clearly.
Go on, Pascal.
Yeah, okay.
Also, Henry C. Carey, I just want to put it in there.
Definitely.
Yeah. Section 94. Let us only observe that nations, as well as individuals, are obliged to trade together for the common benefit of the human race, because mankind stand in need of each other's assistance. Still, however, each nation remains at liberty to consider, in particular cases, whether it be convenient for her to encourage or permit commerce. And as our duty to ourselves is paramount to our duty to others, if one nation finds herself in such circumstances that she thinks foreign commerce dangerous to the state, she may renounce and prohibit it. This the Chinese have done for a long time together, but again, it is only for very serious and important reasons that her duty to herself should dictate such a reserve. Otherwise, she could not refuse to comply with the general duties of humanity. Section.
Referring to protectionist policies of China?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Section 97. Commerce is a common benefit to a nation, and all her members have an equal right to it. Monopoly, therefore, in general, is contrary to the rights of the citizens. However, this rule has its exceptions, suggested even by the interests of the nation. And a wise government may, in certain cases, justly establish monopolies. There are commercial enterprises that cannot be carried on without an energy that requires considerable funds, which surpass the ability of individuals. There are others that would soon become ruinous were they not conducted with great prudence, with one regular spirit, and according to well-supported maxims and rules. These branches of trade cannot be indiscriminately carried on by individuals. Companies are therefore formed under the authority of government, and these companies cannot subsist without an exclusive privilege. It is therefore advantageous to the nation to grant them. Section 98. The conductor of a nation ought to take particular care to encourage the commerce that is advantageous to his people, and to suppress or lay restraints upon that which is to their disadvantage. Gold and silver, having become the common standard of the value of all the articles of commerce, the trade that brings into the state a greater quantity of these metals than it carries out is an advantageous trade. And on the contrary, that is a ruinous one, which causes more gold and silver to be sent abroad than it brings home. This is what is called the balance of trade. The ability of those who have the direction of it consists in making that balance turn in favor of the nation.
So, contrary to the typical description of mercantilism, we see here that a positive balance of trade is one positive aspect to strive for, but it is in no way the be-all and end-all of the point of all of this, as it is so typically described of mercantilism. Next, we'll see a short piece on putting up duties and tariffs.
Section 99. Of all the measures that a wise government may take with this view, we shall only touch here on import duties when the conductors of a state, without absolutely forcing trade, are nevertheless desirous of diverting it to other channels. They lay such duties on the merchandises they would discourage, as will prevent their consumption. Chapter 9. Of the care of the public ways of communication and the right. Section 100. The utility of highways, bridges, canals, and, in a word, of all safe and commodious ways of communication cannot be doubted. They facilitate the trade between one place and another, and render the conveyance of merchandise less expensive, as well as more certain and easy. The merchants are enabled to sell at a better price and to obtain the preference. An attraction is held out to foreigners whose merchandise are carried through the country and diffuse wealth in all the places through which they pass. France and Holland feel the happy consequences of this from daily experience. Section 101. One of the principal things that ought to employ the attention of the government with respect to the welfare of the public in general, and of trade in particular, must then relate to the highways, canals, etc., in which nothing ought to be neglected to render them safe and commodious. France is one of those states where this duty to the public is discharged with the greatest attention and magnificence. Numerous patrols everywhere watch over the safety of travelers. Magnificent roads, bridges, and canals facilitate the communication between one province and another. Louis XIV joined the two seas by a work worthy of the Romans.
And we'll see in the next installment on Hamilton. Hamilton says something almost identical to this in his report on manufacturers, almost as if he was paraphrasing Vattel.
Chapter 10 of Money and Exchange. Section 106. The impression on the coin becoming the seal of its standard and weight. A moment's reflection will convince us that the coinage of money ought not to be left indiscriminately free to every individual, for by that means, frauds would become too common. The coin would soon lose the public confidence, and this would destroy a most useful institution. Hence, money is coined by the authority and in the name of the state or prince, who are its certi. They ought that, therefore, to have a quantity of it coined sufficient to answer the necessities of the country and to take care that it be good, that is to say, that its intrinsic value bear a just proportion to its extrinsic or numerary value.
So what is he advocating for here?
Government coins money.
That's right. So you don't have private coinage. What else? He's advocating for a public mint.
Yeah.
And in saying that the quantity of a coin sufficient to answer the necessities of the country, is he arguing for a form of a public credit system?
Yeah, I think it's Article 1, Section 8, U.S. Constitution.
Yeah, I mean, the fact that he'd been already describing at length the need to consistently improve the internal transportation routes and the canals and roads implies the need for that type of physical growth that would demand an increasing power of credit as well in the nation,
Right. And to what end? For the promotion of the general welfare and the happiness of the nation.
Mm-hmm. Which is the title, Good Rich, your next chapter.
Chapter 11, second object of a good government, to procure the true happiness of the nation. Section 110. Let us continue to lay open the principal objects of a good government. What we have said in the five preceding chapters relates to the care of providing for the necessities of the people and procuring plenty in the state. This is a point of necessity, but it is not sufficient for the happiness of a nation. experience shows that a people may be unhappy in the midst of all earthly enjoyments and in the possession of the greatest riches. Whatever may enable mankind to enjoy a true and solid felicity, it is a second object that deserves the most serious attention of the government. Happiness is the point where center all those duties which individuals and nations owe to themselves. And this is the great end of the law of nature. The desire of happiness is the powerful spring that puts man in motion. Felicity is the end they all have in view, and it ought to be the grand object of the public will. It is then the duty of those who form this public will, or of those who represent it, rulers of the nation, to labor for the happiness of the people, to watch continually over it, and to promote it to the utmost of their power. Section 111. To succeed in this, it is necessary to instruct the people to seek felicity where it is to be found, that is, in their own perfection, and to teach them the means of obtaining it. The sovereign cannot then take too much pain in instructing and enlightening his people and informing them to useful knowledge and wise discipline. Let us leave a hatred of the sciences to the despotic tyrants of the East. They are afraid of having their people instructed because they choose to rule over slaves. But though they are obeyed with the most abject submission, they frequently experience the effects of disobedience and revolt. A just and wise prince feels no apprehensions from the light of knowledge. He knows that it is ever advantageous to a good government. If men of learning know that liberty is the natural inheritance of mankind, on the other hand, they are more fully sensible than their neighbors how necessary it is for their own advantage that this liberty should be subject to a lawful authority, incapable of being slaves. They are faithful subjects.
Here we see advocacy for public education.
Yeah, it's good that he's really taking the time to unfold this idea of happiness from this higher standpoint, because if you read the writings of people like, for example, Aldous Huxley, who calls for like a concentration camp without tears, he also says, you know, we want everybody to be happy, but that's why we should spread LSD everywhere and Soma. Which is where people's like lower idea of happiness comes from. But something like this is very, very beautiful.
Exactly. Where he said above, experience shows that a people may be unhappy in the midst of all earthly enjoyments. Mm. So what is meant by happiness in all this? It's not like you said that, that idea of like feeling good internally of the sense of you know, pleasure, having great pleasure that you can get, like you said, on some intense drugs. It's a happiness that comes through continually perfecting yourself, and the happiness that comes from laboring for the benefit of others.
Mm-hmm. Right. Section 112. The first impressions made on the mind are of the utmost importance for the remainder of life. In the tender years of infancy and youth, the human mind and heart easily receive the seeds of good or evil. Hence, the education of youth is one of the most important affairs that deserve the attention of the government. It ought not to be entirely left to fathers. The most certain way of forming good citizens is to found good establishments for public education, to provide them with able masters, direct them with prudence, and pursue such mild and suitable measures that the citizens will not neglect to take advantage of them.
Okay, why don't we give Pascal a break? Is there anybody else who'd like to volunteer?
We have a volunteer here.
Perfect.
We'll put it up.
Okay.
There, 113. Have a seat.
Okay. Section 113. Who can doubt that the sovereign, the whole nation, ought to encourage the arts and sciences? To say nothing of the many useful inventions that strike the eye of every beholder. Literature and the polite arts enlighten the mind and soften the manners. And if study does not always inspire the love of virtue, it is because it sometimes, and even too often, unhappily meets with an incorrigibly vicious heart. The nation and its conductors ought then to protect men of learning and great artists, and to call forth talents by honors and rewards. Let the friends of barbarism declaim against the sciences and polite arts. Let us, without deigning to answer their vain reasonings, content ourselves with appealing to experience. Section 114. I speak of the freedom of philosophical discussion, which is the soul of the Republic of Letters. What can genius produce when trammeled by fear? Can the greatest man that ever lived contribute much towards enlightening the minds of his fellow citizens if he finds himself constantly exposed to the cavils of captious and ignorant bigots, if he is obliged to be continually on his guard to avoid being accused by innuendo mongers of indirectly attacking the received opinions? Section 116. It is an incontestable truth that the virtues of the citizens constitute the most happy dispositions that can be desired by a just and wise government. Here, then, is an infallible criterion by which the nation may judge of the intentions of those who govern it, if they endeavor to render the great and the common people virtuous. Their views are pure and upright, and you may rest assured that they solely aim at the great end of government, the happiness and glory of the nation. But if they corrupt the morals of the people, spread a taste for luxury, effeminacy, a rage for licentious pleasures, if they stimulate the higher orders to a ruinous pomp and extravagance, beware, citizens. Beware of those corruptors. They only aim at purchasing slaves in order to exercise over them an arbitrary sway.
Matt, is that not what we were just discussing?
Exactly. Yeah, you really foresaw the rise of the Huxleys.
Oh, it's more. Section 158. Next to the care of religion, one of the principal duties of a nation relates to justice. They ought to employ their utmost attention in causing it to prevail in the state, and to take proper measures for having it dispensed to everyone in the most certain, the most speedy, and the least burdensome manner. This obligation flows from the object proposed by uniting in civil society and from the social compact itself. We have seen that men have bound themselves by the engagements of society and consented to divest themselves in its favor of a part of the natural liberty, only with a view of peaceably enjoying what belongs to them and obtaining justice with certainty. The nation would therefore neglect her duty to herself and deceive the individuals if she did not seriously endeavor to make the strictest justice prevail. This attention she owes to her own happiness, repose, and prosperity. Confusion, disorder, and despondency will soon arise in a state when the citizens are not sure of easily and speedily obtaining justice in all their disputes. Without this, the civil virtues will become extinguished and the society weakened.
Okay, so we'll move on. There's not that many more, but we'll move on to book two, Nation Considered in Its Relations to Others. Chapter one, of the common duties of a nation towards others, or of the offices of humanity between nations.
Section one, nations being obliged by nature reciprocally to cultivate human society are bound to observe towards each other all the duties which the safety and advantage of that society require. Section three, the nature and essence of man who, without the assistance of his fellow man, is unable to supply all his wants, to preserve himself, to render himself perfect, and to live happily, plainly shows us that he is destined to live in society. In the interchange of mutual aid, and consequently, that all men are, by their very nature and its essence, obliged to unite their common efforts for the perfection of their own being and that of their condition. The surest method of succeeding in this pursuit is that each individual should exert his efforts first for himself and then for others. Hence, it follows that whatever we owe to ourselves, we likewise owe to others, so far as they stand in need of assistance, and we can grant it to them without being wanting to ourselves. Since then, one nation, in its way, owes to another nation every duty that one man owes to another man, we may confidently lay down this general principle. One state owes to another state whatever it owes to itself, so far as that other stands in real need of its assistance, and the former can grant it without neglecting the duties it owes to itself. Such is the eternal and immutable law of nature. Those who might be alarmed at this doctrine, as totally subversive of the maxims of sound policy, will be relieved from their apprehensions by the two following considerations. Section 6. A nation must not simply confine itself to the preservation of other states. It should likewise, according to its power and their want of its assistance, contribute to their perfection. We have already shown that natural society imposes on it this general obligation. We now come to the proper place for treating the obligations somewhat more in detail. A state is more or less perfect as it is more or less adapted to attain the end of civil society, which consists in procuring for its members everything of which they stand in need for the necessities, the conveniences, and enjoyments of life, and for their happiness in general. In providing for the peaceful enjoyment of property and the safe and easy administration of justice. And finally, in defending itself against all foreign violence. Every nation, therefore, should occasionally and according to its power contribute not only to put another nation in possession of these advantages, but likewise to render it capable of procuring them itself. Accordingly, a learned nation, if applied to for masters and teachers in the sciences, by another nation desirous of shaking off its native barbarism, ought not to refuse such a request. A nation whose happiness it is to live under wise laws should, on occasion, make it a point of duty to communicate them. Thus, when the wise and virtuous Romans sent ambassadors to Greece to collect good laws, the Greeks were far from rejecting so reasonable and so laudable a request. Section 11. It is impossible that nations should mutually discharge all these several duties if they do not love each other. This is the pure source from which the offices of humanity should proceed. They will retain the character and perfection of it. Then nations will be seen sincerely and cheerfully to help each other, earnestly to promote their common welfare, and cultivate peace without jealousy or distrust.
Okay, so I stopped there. I thought that was a nice way to end the excerpts from the book. I should mention that this next portion is heavily indebted to an excellent article by Robert Trout I found published in Fidelio magazine. It's called Life, Liberty, and the Pursuit of Happiness, How the Natural Law Concept of Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz Inspired America's Founding Fathers. And it's on natural law and Vattel mostly. Vattel was the most popular of all writers of the law on the law of nations in America before, but especially after the American Revolution. Following the Revolution, Vattel was cited far more often than Grotius and Pufendorf in court proceedings from 1789 to 1820. And according to another source, he was the most cited legal source in U.S. federal courts for the entire 19th century. Among those citing Vattel in legal cases and government documents were Benjamin Franklin, John Adams, James Wilson, Alexander Hamilton, James Madison, John Jay, and John Marshall. James Madison, as a member of the Continental Congress in 1780, drafted the instructions sent to John Jay for negotiating a treaty with Spain, which quotes at length from the Law of Nations. Jay complained in his reply, which was probably read by the Spanish government, that this letter was not coded, and Vattel's Law of Nations, which he found quoted in a letter from Congress, is prohibited in Spain. Later, John Marshall, during his 34 years as Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, quoted Vattel by far the most among all authors on the Law of Nations. The delegates to the First and Second Continental Congress, which produced the Declaration of Independence, often consulted the Law of Nations as a reference for their discussions. One important reason why the delegates chose to meet in Carpenter's Hall was that the building also housed the Library Company of Philadelphia. The librarian reported that Vattel was one of the main sources consulted by the delegates during the First Continental Congress, which met from September 5th to October 26th, 1774. Charles W.F. Dumas, an ardent supporter of the American cause, printed an edition of the Law of Nations in 1774, with his own notes illustrating how the book applied to the American situation. In 1770, Dumas had met Franklin in Holland and was one of Franklin's key collaborators in his European diplomacy. He sent three copies to Franklin, instructing him to send one to Harvard University and to put one in the Philadelphia Library. Franklin sent this letter to Dumas on December 9, 1775, thanking him for the gift. "I am much obliged by the kind present you have made us of your edition of Vattel. It came to us in good season, when the circumstances of a rising state made it necessary frequently to consult the Law of Nations. Accordingly, that copy which I kept has been continually in the hands of the members of our Congress now sitting." The study of the Law of Nations by the delegates to the Continental Congress to answer questions of the circumstances of a rising state is reflected in the Declaration of Independence of July 4, 1776. As we have seen, Vattel laid down the blueprint for the criteria of a people to overthrow a tyrannical sovereign. That Declaration of Independence states that governments are instituted to fulfill the inalienable rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and can be changed if they fail to meet these obligations to the people. Governments should not be changed for light and transient causes, but only after a long chain of abuses to the fundamental rights of the people, with repeated requests for redress of grievances which were refused. Repeated appeals were made to our British brethren, but since they have been deaf to the voice of justice and consanguinity, we are prepared to face them either in war or in peace. Therefore, we declare ourselves independent of the British Crown, with the full powers of a sovereign government to levy war, conclude peace, contract alliances, establish commerce, and to do all other things, acts and things which independent states may of right do. The inclusion of the central conception of the law of nations, Vattel's Leibnizian concept of happiness as one of the three inalienable rights, is a crucial statement of the Declaration's Leibnizian character. The Declaration of Independence was prepared by a committee consisting of Ben Franklin, Thomas Jefferson, John Adams, Robert Livingston, and Roger Sherman. Jefferson was assigned by this committee to write the draft of the Declaration after John Adams turned down the task. The fact that Jefferson was a strong proponent of the philosophy of John Locke is often used as evidence that the Declaration was based on Locke's philosophy. However, Locke had argued in his two treatises on government that the fundamental right of men is to life, liberty, and property. The inclusion of the pursuit of happiness rather than property as an inalienable right was a crucial statement that the American Revolution would be a battle for the establishment of a true republic, rather than merely a dispute between two groups of aristocrats over the division of property. And we know that Jefferson's first draft was heavily edited by Benjamin Franklin. American writers quoted the Law of Nations on constitutional law almost immediately after the book's publication. In 1764, James Otis of Massachusetts argued in one of the leading pamphlets of the day, The Rights of the British Colonies Asserted and Proved, that the colonial charters were constitutional arrangements. He then quoted Vattel that the right to establish a constitution lies with the nation as a whole, and that Parliament lacked the right to change the fundamental principles of the British Constitution. The Boston revolutionary leader Samuel Adams wrote in 1772, Vattel tells us plainly and without hesitation that the supreme legislative cannot change the constitution, that their authority does not extend so far, and that they ought to consider the fundamental laws as sacred, if the nation has not, in very express terms, given them power to change them. In a debate with the colonial governor of Massachusetts in 1773, John Adams quoted Vattel that the Parliament does not have the power to change the Constitution. The adoption of a constitution by the Constitutional Congress in 1787, based upon Leibnizian principles rather than British legal doctrine, was certainly not inevitable. However, British legal experts such as Blackstone, who argued that the Parliament and King could change the Constitution, were increasingly recognized by the Americans as proponents of arbitrary power, much as Leibniz attacked the voluntarism of Pufendorf and Locke. The early revolutionary leaders' emphasis on Vattel as the authority on constitutional law, with his conception that a nation must choose the best constitution to ensure its perfection and happiness, had very fortunate consequences for the United States and the world when the U.S. Constitution was later written. So I'd like to end here. I think it's been pretty clear that in starting this, I quickly realized that it's not so much about the American system of economics, but it's about an entire American system, that there's much more to it than just some economic principles. And I hope to continue along this tack in the future installments in this series. I'd like to end today with a mention of Leibniz's work promoting Chinese culture in Europe, because in preparing this lecture and watching the excellent presentation by Dr. Quan Li on Confucius a few weeks ago, I couldn't help but compare the notions of the mandate of heaven and the promotion of the general welfare. I see the loss of the mandate of heaven analogous to a leader who fails to promote the general welfare. Leibniz corresponded with Jesuit missionaries in China and published them as Novissima Sinica, or the latest news from China, with a preface from him stating, "I judge that this mission is the greatest affair of our time, as much for the glory of God and the propagation of the Christian religion, as for the general good of men and the growth of the arts and sciences, among us as well as among the Chinese. For this is a commerce of light, which could give to us at once their work of thousands of years and render ours to them, and double, so to speak, our true wealth for one and the other. This is something greater than one imagines." Leibniz used this term, commerce of light, to describe his vast correspondence, which will be the starting point for part two in this series. Quoting here from Antognatz's book on Leibniz, Leibniz told Peter the Great of Russia that this commerce of light was no idle pastime, as his benefactor Georg Ludwig seemed to think, but a key facet of his commitment to the improvement of the human condition. It was a model for the advancement of knowledge through which new insights were reached through communication with people who saw the same universe and the same truth from a different perspective. As we will see in part two, the fruits of that commerce of light bear directly on the future founding fathers of America. To conclude, I will ask, is the American system universal? From my perspective, it boils down to whether someone believes that there is a universal form of the good, a Platonic idea. Everything else about the American system descends from that, according to Leibniz and Vattel. A republic, internal improvements, developing the scientific and technological potential of a nation, all of these are founded on pursuing the good as our reason dictates, motivated by agape, love of your fellow man, the only road to happiness. The pursuit of the good will figure heavily in our next installment, where we examine the lives of John Winthrop, the two Mathers, and Benjamin Franklin.
Thank you, Sam. Very nice.
Okay, so I am available for questions or comments or discussion if anybody has anything.
Yeah, and what we'll do, like last week, if you have a question, put it in the chat, and that way I'll call upon you to throw it at Sam. I'm already seeing, hold on, I'm just opening up my chats right now. Okay, yeah, we've got a lot of thank yous and great presentations, but no questions yet. So if anybody has something.
Go ahead, Gerald.
Oh, Sam, that was a great class. Earlier when Pascal was reading from Vattel, there was one section 28. I can't remember what book that was from, but my request is, can I get a copy of that? Because I'd like to use it when I do my class. It was very interesting.
Yeah, it's online, actually, so I will post it in the chat. And
All right, we have one question from Dave.
Hey, Sam. Good class. Nice to see you.
Thank you. You too, sir.
Yeah, I was just thinking, though, based on hearing everything that we've heard from Leibniz and his collaborators, isn't it safe to say that the American system was more, it seems like it's just a systemization of what, of these principles. Like, most of these principles were already elaborated, because as I hear the word American system, it makes me think even more like it's more of a Leibnizian system almost. You know what I mean? Like, it seems most of the principles were elucidated beforehand, and the American Revolution was the political battle to bring that into existence.
Like, yeah, I totally agree with that. I said in the beginning that Friedrich List, who was a follower of Hamilton's, called it the national system, which may be a better name for it, because it is truly a universal system. It's not just something that only applies to America. And when I first started this, when I first proposed it to Matt, what I wanted to do for my own knowledge is really dig deep on everything that Hamilton wrote. And as I started to investigate, I started to find, you know, first influences on Hamilton. Vattel was one of the first ones that I found, which through researching Vattel, discovered his ties to Leibniz, deep ties. I couldn't stop going back in time before Hamilton to the point where I said to Matt, I'm going to move Hamilton to the next series, or maybe even part three, because we'll see in part two, you know, with the Winthrops, the two Mathers, Ben Franklin, and some of the other collaborators of Leibniz, how much time, I don't even know if we'll have time to do justice to Hamilton. But yeah, that's what I was finding is that Hamilton didn't exist in a bubble, and he didn't conceive of all this on his own. And why I wanted to put so much emphasis on Vattel is because I think that there hasn't been as much emphasis on his ties to Leibniz, and also on how much he was an influence on Hamilton, which I will definitely cover extensively in the class on Hamilton.
Hey, Sam, I got a question, and then Scott has, I think, a little question too. But you mentioned very briefly that Vattel, there was a crackdown on Vattel around the time after World War I regarding the League of Nations process and world government.
Yeah.
Can you say a little bit more about this counterattack? Because it's true, I had never really heard of Vattel until I encountered the Schiller Institute and these things, and considering such a major role that his mind played in American world history. What was this crackdown about? Can you say anything about that?
Well, it went, once the world government project got started, Vattel, who in the 1800s, because the world government program got started in the late 1800s, early 1900s. So Vattel had to be minimized, because the whole foundation of international law prior to the conception of world government was that each nation is fully sovereign and independent, and that world government, like where the sovereignty of nations is in any way reduced, is illegal under international law. And so there was a freak out about Vattel, where it was decided that we have to, you know, remove the Vattelian influence in order to go forward with this world government program. And this was from that article that I mentioned. So like how deeply I went into that, I don't have, you know, quotes and sources of you know, world government advocates plotting to remove Vattel, but certainly it's understandable, at least, that if you want world government, you can't keep Vattel's conception of international law. The two are not compatible.
Yeah, you definitely would prefer people read Hobbes and Grotius, for sure.
So,
all right, Scott, you had a comment.
Scott's got something.
Yeah, Scott. Why don't you just say that out loud instead of the chat?
Hi, great presentation, Sam. Fantastic. I had no idea Vattel was. Wow, that's amazing. That's great stuff. Okay, so one of my first questions actually is this intrigue about Ireland. I'm now it's the second time I've heard this issue of industrial development in Ireland. To me, that's coming out of left field. And Matthew Carey is one of the key organizers of this. So is there some more backstory? Does anyone know more about this? I mean, it to me, it dovetails with all the way up to, you know, because there was a pro-development king, King Charles III, I think, of Spain. And traditionally, Ireland has had a longstanding relation with Spain. And that's where you get the Black Irish grouping from. And only until, I guess after the Glorious Revolution, do you get a shift in Ireland, you know, to industry on the eastern coast as opposed to the western coast. Anyway, it intrigues me. There's a lot, and it makes a lot of sense for the British cracking down and, you know, on the Irish. So I'm just wondering about that. If there's anything more on that and something to go into.
That I don't have for you, but certainly Matthew Carey, after the class on Hamilton, the plan is to learn more about the two Careys and Friedrich List as the natural, you know, successors to Hamilton, and Henry Clay as well. So what I can try and do is get some more info on that. I mean, we know for certain that the Irish Republicans were heavily influenced by America, and you know, Americans went over to help fight in Ireland. The Irish sent people to America to learn and take the knowledge back to Ireland. You know, they founded the Republic of Ireland based on the American Republic. So there definitely was a lot of American influence on the founding of the Irish Republic. But specifics on that, I'll try and get for you in the next class.
Yeah. Sorry, just quick on that point too. I think the circles of Jonathan Swift are going to be pretty interesting. I just found out had written a pamphlet encouraging Irish manufacturers while he was the head of Trinity College. And people like John Winthrop and a lot of the key leaders of the early Massachusetts Bay Settlement all study at Trinity College as well during the time that Swift was the leader there.
Right, and actually Jonathan Swift and Leibniz were in communication through Caroline of Ansbach, who was very fond of Leibniz and one of his close collaborators. So there was a direct connection between Leibniz and Jonathan Swift. And Leibniz had many other collaborators in England as well.
Yeah, Jerry, when he gives his class in 2 weeks, could probably say a little bit about this material as well. Yeah.
Okay, awesome.
Oh, I see Jerry's. You got to put him on the spot there. We'll see. You got 2 weeks, Jerry.
Are you have you already written a paper based on some like the kind of thing you did today in your class?
Have I?
Yeah, it seems like this is the way you presented it. Like there's like a dialogue between these different minds. It's kind of, I think, like the Federalist Papers, you know, there's all these back and forth letters and commentary. This is like the same thing, but before, like this is the conversation that then defined the later American system conversation, it seems.
It definitely could be a good article or series of articles, but no, this is original to this presentation.
That's good. I feel special.
I second Dave's desire that this be transmitted into a written form as well.
Yeah, I think this is super. This would be very provocative. It sort of forces all these American history scholars and whatnot to kind of take a step back, and you know, they find themselves on a completely different plane. This is a very good.
Yeah, I found one in this doing research. I found one. I can't remember which university it was now, but I found one paper from a doctoral candidate, and it was the most ridiculous argument that it was about Abraham Lincoln and the protectionism that he brought in as contrary, I guess you could say, to the American experience, that, you know, America was founded on free trade and individual liberty, and that Lincoln sort of upended all that with his Republicans and his protectionism, like absolutely no understanding of, you know, Hamilton, Ben Franklin, or of Vattel and of all these ideas which were so fundamental to the founding of the country. And I think Vattel is really useful in arguing against, you know, the tendency of libertarians to see, you know, virtue in pure self-interest, that you do have to have self-interest, but you also have to live for the benefit of the other as well.
Scott has written something. Scott, what are you saying there? More on what?
You mentioned a personage, Elmaki.
Burlamaki.
Burlamaki.
He was Vattel's, he taught Vattel natural law. Yeah.
Steven, okay. you gotta run?
Well, so he's the one who, can you go over that just a little bit briefly again? He's the principal guy of the separation of church and state.
And of the separation of powers.
Separation
so one of the fundamental concepts in the American system is that powers are separate. So the executive is separate from the legislature, which is separate from the judiciary, and they all have their own, you know, separate domains, which they guard very jealously. And it helps to promote the longevity of the Republic by making sure that not one component of government takes more power than it should. And the Founding Fathers leaned very heavily on Burlamaki for that. He was also the first to establish the pursuit of happiness as a right under natural law. And he was very heavily Platonic.
Cool.
So yeah, what we see, I mean, I know that Matt and the Rising Tide Foundation are very big on, you know, the question of Plato versus Aristotle. And we see, like, time and time again here, just pure Platonism and opposition to the ideas of Aristotle. And I thought that it was quite pertinent to the aims of the Rising Tide Foundation.
A question too comes up about the notion of felicity, because this is mentioned by Vattel so often, and of course Leibniz, really. And to me, it could use a further definition in modern terms. You know, that I think what he's grasping at is a very high-natured principle of human striving or condition, perhaps, you know, but, and it's not, you could say happiness, but it's, to me, I'm getting a notion of a faculty for something, like you could say, greater power, a greater tranquil, I don't know, greater, you know, self satisfact, you know, like discovering oneself through the freedom to act in a constructive way, something like that. And in that way, it's constructive in being a, you know, a value and adding to the common good, which is also reflective, you know, of one's benefit. One thing that's kind of missing today is the notion of, like, this, yeah, welfare of the other, benefit of the other, and what that means. And Kennedy put it in the vernacular well. It's ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. and this whole notion that we are a product of our country or of our nation to the degree that it functions to meet our needs and allows us to be allows us to strive for our best nature. And so I don't know, I just this term could be, yeah, to develop it in the more modern vernacular could be very productive and helpful.
Well, I see, I translate felicity, and keep in mind that all of these terms in English are generally translations. So where we see that Leibniz says that justice is nothing else than the charity of the wise, that is to say, goodness towards others, which is conformed to wisdom. And in turn, wisdom is nothing else than the science of felicity. To me, I translate felicity as happiness, but not happiness as in some sort of sensation of pleasure, but in the conception of happiness as understood by people like Leibniz and Vattel, that we as rational creatures, when we use our reason to pursue our own perfection, to learn and discover new principles about the universe, that is in effect the glory of God, that in the conception of man created in the image of God, that our ability to reason is a shadow of God himself, and that using our reason to promote the welfare of ourselves and our neighbors and to advance the knowledge of humankind is the way that you pursue happiness or felicity.
Well put. Yes, I would agree with that. That's what I'm, yeah. And that this is innate in human nature.
Exactly. Yeah. And that it's universal.
Yes. Right.
All right, guys. It's running out to 7:00. We have an appointment, unfortunately, we have to get to. I'm really, really happy that we made it through this beautiful gestalt. And just for everyone to keep in mind, next week, we have Pascal, who's going to be unfolding the story, the tragedy of Quebec, the potentials, the lost potentials of 1837-38, following up on some of the ideas that have been developed this week, last week, and the week before. Followed up the week afterwards by Jerry, who's going to be tackling a forgotten part of our own history that deals with Ireland, Haiti, Toussaint Louverture, and their relationship with some of the best Republican minds of America, especially Alexander Hamilton. Following that up, we're going to have a few presentations by Nick Jones, by Cynthia Chung, who will be tackling the life and mind and person of Frederick Douglass, the role he played in history, along with Martin Seif, who will be giving us something special on the American-Russian relationship with a focus on the Civil War period, but a lot more than that. There, I think he was just now. and then we'll round out this lecture series with a presentation on William Gilpin, the fight to create a continental America, build rail across the continent, but not to just unite the continent, but to open it up to a relationship with China, especially connected to the person of President Sun Yat-sen, the first Republican revolutionary of China and the father of modern China in many ways. Nick, before that, will have spoken about the Pan-African movement, people like Kwame Nkrumah, Gigante Diop and others who largely continued this American struggle, this Leibnizian struggle in the African context, which was disrupted by many, many imperial manipulations in the 50s and 60s and 70s to the very day, and which the Belt and Road Initiative has a chance to revive. So we've got a fun little road ahead of us, and we're all looking forward to Sam's part two and part three in coming cycles beyond this. So this is going to be good. It's going to be very fruitful.
Thank you for the opportunity, and I will keep you posted on the progress of part two.
Excellent.
Thanks. Take care, guys. See you soon.
Bye, everyone.
Ciao. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Yes, thanks, everyone.
Thanks, Sam.
Thanks.